Hello all, warm welcome to this lecture series on organizational behavior. I am Dr. M.P. Ganesh and this is going to be our fourth lecture in the first chapter, which is on organizational behavior and introduction. So I'll quickly summarize what happened in our previous three lectures. So we try to define what is meant by organizational behavior by understanding what is organization, what is behavior, and what is organizational behavior. We also looked at some of the basic assumptions of organizational behavior as a discipline. We also looked at the fundamental ideas behind organizational behavior as a discipline. We also looked at how organizational behavior as a discipline tries to understand individual behavior in workplace at different levels. So in the previous lecture we looked at the why do we have to study organizational behavior, or what kind of use does organizational behavior has for students and also for managers. So one important application of organizational behavior as a discipline is human resource management. So most organizations have this function called human resource management, and many of its practices are based on the theoretical assumptions made by organizational behavior as a discipline. We also looked at the application of organizational behavior in organizational context. So we discussed a lot about the idea of work-life balance and how to improve employee performance in long run, through that how to influence organizational effectiveness. Okay, so this is where we stopped, and in this lecture we are going to talk about the history behind organizational behavior as a discipline, or how does organizational behavior as a discipline evolved over a period of time. Okay, so organizational behavior as a discipline emerged from industrial psychology. So industrial psychology can be called as the mother of organizational behavior. Why? Because many of these principles of industrial psychology are applied in or used in organizational behavior as a discipline. So, but what is the difference between industrial psychology and organizational behavior? One important difference between industrial psychology and organizational behavior is industrial psychology draws heavily from psychology as a discipline, as the name suggests. Organizational behavior is a multidisciplinary area of study. If you remember in one of those slides, we saw OB as a multidisciplinary field of study. Organizational behavior, even though it borrows heavily from psychology, or it uses psychological principles to explain most of the behavior of individuals in workplace, it also uses principles or theories from sociology, anthropology, political science, even economics and other social science disciplines. So that is the difference. So if you want to understand how organizational behavior as a discipline evolved, you need to understand some information about industrial psychology. So before I move on, I was asking you about the role of World War in industrial psychology. If you remember the previous lecture, I asked you to read about this particular topic, how World War contributed industrial psychology. So industrial psychology as a discipline saw a rapid growth during World Wars, both in World War I and World War II. One area where the role of industrial psychology became very important during this period is selection of army personnel for fighting the World War. So especially during World War, there was a huge requirement for people or soldiers to fight the war. So, and it was also very urgent, you cannot spend a lot of time to select people, and also selecting wrong personnel can have huge impact for the country. Because, you know, if you can't select the right kind of people, they may fail to perform during emergency situations like war. So Henderson psychology helped recruitment in terms of development of psychological test, especially intelligence test. It helped a lot because you can recruit a lot of people in one go. So many of these tests are group tests, which means some 100 people were made to sit in one place. They were given a question paper kind of a thing, which is called a questionnaire. So they filled, these respondents filled these questionnaires, and it was very easy to score or to understand the how much a person got a mark in that particular test. So it's similar to our aptitude test now, okay, which is conducted in a very mass scale, and it is very easy to score, more like, you know, objective type questions, and it was very easy to make decisions based on the answers. So the mass recruitment was very much possible because of these questionnaires created by industrial psychologists around this time, which is during World War. So both you know, government as well as psychologists, they benefited by these phenomena. Government benefited because it was very easy for them to recruit a lot of people for the army in short period of time, and also psychologists, through this data which they got, they were able to refine their questionnaires. You know, they were able to fine tune their questionnaires in a better way. During World War, industrial psychology also helped, or what happened during World War also helped industrial psychology to understand better about leadership styles. So theories on leadership style, theories on managerial styles emerged from observation of you know, army personnel and army leaders during World War. So this is how there was a huge synergetic relationship which emerged during World War between industrial psychology and army. Okay, so having said that, I've also given the list of significant contributors in the area of industrial psychology during the initial days of industrial psychology. If you see, many of them are in the area of advertising and also vocational and guidance training, especially in schools. Psychology had a very strong role in developing questionnaires, intelligence tests to select people for higher education, and also help people, students, make better decisions in terms of what future educational decisions they have to make. And also there were also efforts made on how to improve industrial efficiency, how to help organizations perform better by choosing right kind of people, making them work better, and things like that, mostly in industrial setup, in manufacturing setup. So if you are more interested, I would recommend you to search these scientists' name in Wikipedia or in Google, and understand their background also. Okay. One of the key contributors to organizational behavior indirectly is Frederick Taylor. Or one important phenomena which happened, which significantly contributed to organizational behavior as a discipline, is scientific management movement. Scientific management movement is propagated or found by a person called Frederick W. Taylor. If you are a management scholar, you would have heard of Frederick Taylor in your Introduction to Management book. And if you remember, Frederick Taylor is also called as the father of modern management. So why Frederick Taylor is called as father of modern management? Because some of his principles which he proposed were very useful in improving industrial efficiency around during that point in time. Frederick Taylor is also heavily criticized for his approach for treating humans as experimental subjects. or making them work like machines. If you want to quickly understand Frederick Taylor's idea of scientific management, Frederick Taylor called this theory scientific management, or managing people through scientific methods. So what Frederick Taylor proposed was very simple. He proposed four important principles. And before we look at these principles, we have to look at what prompted Frederick Taylor to come up with these principles. Frederick Taylor was an engineer by background. He was not a psychologist or a behavioral scientist. He was trained in engineering. So when he was working in many organizations as an engineer or a supervisor, one thing he noticed in many manufacturing organizations were a phenomenon called soldiering. So he defined soldiering as people intentionally slowing down their work. So what he noticed was workers, when they were working collectively, when many people are working together collectively, these workers try to slow down their pace of work. Why? Because they don't want to become a threat for other employees. What it means is, when someone performs better than others, then that becomes the criteria for others. So collectively, people were working slow so that other employees were not pressurized for working more. So one way to overcome, so this led to a strong attrition, a strong impact on organizations by reduced productivity. So what Frederick Taylor thought was, instead of making employees work on their own, we should find out the best way to do a work, and we should train people in that particular method, and then we will use methods to ensure everybody performs to that level. So to put it in simple words, the first principle of scientific management says, let's say if there is a work which involves multiple tasks. So there is a job which has multiple tasks. A job like, let's say, bricklaying. Bricklaying means, if you would have seen masons, people who build houses or build buildings, they are called masons. So they lay bricks. Laying bricks means, let's say you take a brick, you keep it, and then put a cement on it, keep a next brick next to it, and then you place bricks on top of the bricks. So this is like building a wall, let's say. Okay. So if this is the job, this particular job has multiple subtasks. Tasks like taking the brick, placing the brick, placing cement on it, placing another brick, ensuring that the level is correct, and then measuring to which level you want to build, and then again you are placing the brick. So it's a repetitive task which has repetitive job which has multiple tasks. So if this is the overall job, you try to understand each of those tasks and see how each of those tasks can be planned in a way that, or can be done in a way that, it uses less energy and less resources. If some task of that entire job is not required or can be replaced by better methods, you need to replace it. For example, in India, many times you would have seen these laborers, manual laborers, they carry brick in their head or construction stuff in their head. So how this is like waste of energy, and it unnecessarily burdens the worker, and also it involves cost. If to carry some amount of brick, you need many people. So instead of that, how to reduce it or modify it, use a instrument which can be rolled, which you can use it to take the bricks without carrying it in your head. Or let's say, instead of bending down and taking the brick, you keep all the brick in a platform, you can easily pick it up and place the brick. So this is how you can scientifically study the entire job and reduce unnecessary tasks and improve efficiency. And also, for each of those necessary tasks, you measure how much time it takes, okay, and see what is the ideal time, or what is the average time taken by most people to do that task. So if you do this, you will know if somebody is not fulfilling this time, or if somebody is slow, then it means this person is either intentionally wasting time, or this person has no capacity to fulfill that particular task. So you select someone who can suit that particular kind of a job. So that is the second point. So you have established proper methods to do a particular job, and you know how much time it takes for each of those tasks. When you are recruiting someone, you select someone who is capable enough to fulfill that task in that particular prescribed time, which you already established with scientific methods, and also train them so that they will be able to perform to their fullest. And the third point in scientific management is you teach them methods. Whenever there is a performance dip, you try to understand why there is a performance dip and cooperate with the workers and ensure that they are using the proper methods. So many times the dip might happen because workers may not completely follow the instructions or the best method to do a particular task. So you cooperate with them, you train the workers and help them perform better, follow the rules better. Fourth point is, doing a job is the role of the worker. Making decisions is the role of the management. So how to do a job better is not the role of the worker. The role of the worker is to do his or her job, perform, do the task. How to do it better is the role of the management or the manager. Because the manager uses scientific methods, or researchers use scientific methods, experts use scientific methods to understand the task better. So whatever instructions the management comes up with are scientifically based. So they cannot be questioned by the worker. The worker's role is to follow the instructions and cooperate with the management. So these are the four principles Taylor used. And whenever someone performs to the fullest, someone who performs according to the instruction and according to the standards, you need to incentivize them. You have to pay them a bonus amount. And also, if someone performs more than the criteria fixed, more than the average you have fixed, you have to pay them incentives. So this sounds very very good, isn't it? It sounds very, very reasonable, isn't it? But why do people criticize Frederick Taylor, or what is the problem in this approach? I'll show you a small video which is for 7 minutes, that video talks about, gives a holistic picture of what are the problems with scientific management as a principle. Are you ready to watch the video?
In Britain, the Vulcan Motor Company was proud to film the way their workers assembled cars, slowly and carefully, by hand. Craftsmen worked in their own way, at their own pace. The whole process took several weeks from start to finish. These handmade cars were so expensive that a wide gulf separated those who built them from those who bought them. But the days when cars were just luxuries for the rich were drawing to a close. In 1908, one man's vision would change manufacturing and create a new market. Henry Ford set out to make the simplest car ever. A car for rural America, a 20th century equivalent of the horse and buggy. To produce the Model T cheaply, Ford knew he had to change the way cars were built. That meant changing the way his workers worked. As he reorganized his factory to turn out Model T's, he was influenced by the efficiency expert, Frederick Taylor. Taylor complained that hardly a workman can be found who doesn't devote his time to studying just how slowly he can work. And then he devoted his life to speeding them up. When Taylor was brought in, he first timed the workers with stopwatches and noted their every movement. In a famous experiment at an ironworks, he reorganized a worker named Schmidt. Previously, Schmidt had hand-carried 12 tons of pig iron a day up from a wagon. After Taylor rearranged things, the tolerant Mr. Schmidt found himself carrying 47 tons, and production had been raised 300%. Called into an office, Taylor helped the world's fastest typist type even faster. The new world record of 150 words a minute was achieved by Margaret Owen, and Taylor claimed much of the credit. At Ford's factory, Taylorism meant dividing automobile production into simple, repetitive steps. There would be no need for skilled craftsmen with years of apprenticeship. Men could learn to do any job quickly. A trained wheelwright no longer made each wheel in its entirety. Wheel making was broken down into almost 100 steps, done by different men at different machines. It was much faster, but workers could still complete only 200 cars a day. So in 1913, Ford introduced his most revolutionary change yet.
In those days, each car was built from the frame up on stationary wooden horses.
The Ford Motor Company filmed a reenactment of how Henry Ford first tried out his new idea.
Henry Ford watched it for a while, then he had an inspiration. Instead of moving the men past the cars, why not move the cars past the men? So on one hot August morning, they tried it that way. A husky young fellow put a rope over his shoulder, and Henry Ford called, "Let's go." And at that very moment, as the workmen began to fasten the parts onto the slowly moving car, the assembly line was born.
Soon, assembly lines were up and running in Ford's factory. The lines became the key to mass production, a system that would remain virtually unchanged for most of the century. A network of clanging conveyors was used to deliver parts to an exact point on the line. The workers became an integral part of the great machine, and management set the pace without discussion or negotiation, for unions were forbidden. The men faced new pressure as the final assembly line beat out the rhythm for the whole factory. There was no way they could stop or slow it down. Few stood the pace and din for long. Men tried it for a few weeks, then quit. But Ford had an answer. The company was making record profits. The time taken to build each car had dropped to 1.5 hours, so he could afford to raise pay. When he announced he was doubling wages to the unheard-of level of $5 a day, the factory was besieged with applicants. Other car makers adopted the Ford method. Ford's recipe, mass production, low costs, high wages, was creating not only cheap cars, but well-paid workers. Above all, it was the constant supply of new men arriving in Detroit that made it possible. The company set the terms. If they worked fast and obeyed orders, they got the wages. It was a game for which Ford made the rules simple but strict. High pay for hard work.
What Mr. Ford wanted from his workers was a good day's work on the shift. Go home, eat and go to bed, and you'd be save your strength and get up and give them a good day the next day. That just pops in my mind, and it is the truth.
Ford's private security force, the Plant Protection Service, kept discipline. Anyone who recruited for the unions was fired. Company spies kept a lookout for those considered to be troublemakers. Workers on the Rouge lines had never had job security. Now those lucky enough still to have jobs became increasingly powerless.
You couldn't even talk to guys on the job, not let the foreman see you. There were whispering going on and whatnot. My friend of mine was fired 3 times, a guy by the name of John Gallo, for smiling. if you went to the bathroom, you had to get permission from your supervisor. And if you was in there over 3 or 4 minutes, you would had one of the service guys, if you had to use the bathroom to relieve your bowels, he would come up and put his foot where you flushed, and he said, stand up. And if you, when you stand up, if there wasn't something in that toilet, out you go.
I'll quickly summarize few issues in this particular video. We'll look at these, we'll critically evaluate, or we'll try to understand what is said in the video elaborately in the next lecture. This video is about how Frederick Taylor's principles were used by Ford. You would have heard of Henry Ford. You know, he's one of those very popular management gurus, or very, very revered management person in the history of management. So this particular video talks about how using Frederick Taylor's principle had a mixed effect, a kind of a complicated effect on the organization, and also on the employees. So one important, even though using Taylor's methods helped improve productivity, which led to cheap cars or affordable cars, which helped middle class to own a car, which is many middle class people's dream, it also led to some consequences which are not very desirable for employees. One important consequence is employees were made to feel that they are part of the larger machinery. In other words, the individuality or the humanness in managing people were lost. Because of this assembly line phenomena, every employee is also like a machine, a part of a machine. This is how they have been made to feel. And the second important criticism is employees felt more and more powerless, because the speed of the assembly line is decided by the top level management. You don't, as an employee, you don't have control over what you are doing. You know, it's all moving, and you need to adapt to that speed of that assembly line machine. So that led to powerlessness. So these are two important criticisms. There are a lot of other criticisms, and also there are a lot of very interesting issues which is there in this video. We will watch the we will discuss the video in the next lecture. So as a homework, I would request you to watch the video again. I will give the link below for this video in YouTube, or the same lecture video, you can find the video. Watch it again with the subtitles, and think about the positives and negatives of Taylorism in Ford's company. We'll meet in the next lecture. Till then, stay safe. See you again. Bye.